Good morning. Morning. It's good to see you here today. I hope you're doing well. Today is our Mission Sunday, and Clay's here with us. He spoke with us last year, but we wanted to highlight another mission that's going on, and we thought his was a good one, local. And so he's going to be back with us here today as well, and we're looking forward to him being here. I'm going to say a little bit more about that before he gets up. But you'll see the tables that we have set up. These are the missions that we are doing as a church. You'll see kind of the items around there to let you know the ministries and missions we're a part of. Our mission for Food Pantry, Clothes Closet are two big ones that we have a hand in our community. And I will say that our food pantry is very low. We have probably the lowest food that we've had in a while as far as green beans and corn, for example. Those are things that we normally have on hand. We just have had such a large influx of people who are in need of groceries, and we do try to limit that to Lee County residents, and we also try to limit that to once every other month for people to come and get groceries. And so but we do have a big need. And so if you're at the grocery store and you see a buy one get one or something, or you're buying groceries and you want to get green beans and corn are a good thing, other vegetables that go in there as well. So any of that kind of stuff is a good thing for the food pantry. We are going to be having our Coke giveaway coming up soon. October the, what's the date of that, Ms. Garland? Coke giveaway? The 12th. October the 12th. I will say that we've moved our clothes closet over to Miss Mary Green's house. We're going to be getting a sign that says Mary's house and has our clothes closet, and I think she'd be very proud of that. But that is working out excellent in a lot of different ways, and so you'll see the ramp there, Methodist Men built, and I'm proud of that as well. And so we're just kind of moving along in the ministries that we have, but today is a day to kind of highlight those things. As far as announcements goes, you'll see in your bulletin upcoming events, September the 12th, if you'll put this down, we have a finance meeting. If you're on the finance team, I hope you'll be a part of that. It's also charge conference season, so we've got to kind of nail down pastor salary and all that kind of stuff, voted on by the church council. And then we'll be ready for charge conference, and the Walk to Emmaus gathering is that night as well, if you're part of the Walk to Emmaus. Also, you'll see SBRC meeting. It's going to be next Sunday afternoon at 3. We're going to be getting together to talk about the stuff that's going on. Again, pastor salary, those kind of things. So I hope you'll be a part of that. And then the men's meeting, September the 19th. Luke is going to be sharing his testimony that evening, and so I hope you'll come and be a part of that. Looking forward to hearing from Luke, and that'll be a good night. We'll have a meal just together. There's other information there as far as meetings and things coming up. I hope you'll pay attention to those items. Last, I want to lift up Wednesday Night Supper. We had our first Wednesday Night Supper back since we finished before summer. And now we're back kind of getting back into the swing of things, which is a good thing. And we have such a good time. We're watching The Chosen and having conversation about that after we watched the episode. And that's been really good. It's facilitated a lot of good conversation and questions. So that's what the adults are doing. Children and youth will be doing their own thing at 6:15. Our supper is from 5:45 to 6:15. We're going to be having spaghetti. I don't know where you can go and get a spaghetti meal for $5. So I think that's a pretty good deal. So I hope you'll come, be a part of that time of fellowship as we have a meal and then have ministry after that. All right, with all that being said now, if you would, let's stand as we invite God to be a part of our time together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come here today for many different reasons. Some of us are carrying burdens and baggage. Some of us, Lord, are here, and we just felt led to be here today. We don't know why. Father, for whatever reason we're here, we just pray that you would meet us here in a very real way, that you'd speak to our hearts and lives, and that we would be able to lay down any burden, because I know you are far more capable of carrying our burdens than we are carrying them ourselves. So I thank you for that. I just ask that you'd speak to our hearts and lives. If there's repentance needed, we would find that forgiveness here, and that we would walk in an upright way as we follow after you. May all that's done and said in these moments bring glory and honor to your name. For it's in your name we pray. We love you, Father. Amen. Ms. Carlin will come now and lead us in our opening hymn.
All right. Good morning.
Good
to see everybody. I was out last Sunday, so I just missed y'all so bad. You just don't know. Probably missed you a lot more than you missed me, but anyway, I'm glad we're all here together. It warms my heart. So we're going to start off praising the Lord with How Great Thou Art. It's got four verses, and they'll be on the screen, and let's just sing to Him. Oh, Lord, my God. Stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Thou art, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross, burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart when I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Amen. And you can be seated.
As we go now for a time of prayer, we want to remember Miss Joyce Callahan. She found out this last week that she has colon cancer. She is going to be having surgery this week. Do you know Monday? Don't know yet, but hopefully this week sometime. We're thankful that it is operable, so she'll be able to have surgery and take that out. So please be praying for Miss Joyce. We have others that we're going to be praying for. Dr. Philip Reese, a husband of Mindy Fagan, passed away in May, and we're going to be having his funeral this Saturday coming up at the church, celebration of life for him. They attended for a good while, and he had Parkinson's and ended up just having to stay home from that, and we had not seen them in a while, but we do want to pray for Mindy and as they kind of go through this closure time. Want to lift up Joseph Jones. He's been dealing with an infection and been in the hospital for the last week. I don't think he's out yet, is he, Ms. Dale? To your knowledge. So please keep Joseph. Many know him as well. He's been very, very sick dealing with that. I know we have others that we want to be praying for and lift up. I hope that you'll put any need that you have here on your bookmark there, and you can turn that in. If it's something unspoken, maybe you don't want anybody to know about, but you want somebody to be praying for it, simply check the unspoken box, and we'll be praying for that unspoken. We may not know it or not even know who it goes with. Sometimes we get them turned in, and it has no name on it. But we pray for it because God does know what that unspoken is, and he is more than capable of meeting us where we are with that. I do want to say that following the service, we're going to be having a mission meal. It's a donation soup, and we got 8 different soups, and you make a donation, and that goes 100% to missions. If you're not going to be able to stay for the meal, we hope that you do because we have plenty of soups over there. And you'd like to make a donation to missions, you can put that in this basket here on the altar as you leave if you're not going to be able to stay, or you can put it in the altar, the offering plate, and put Mission Sunday on there. And again, 100% of what you give will go to our missions that we do here in the church. With that being said, let's have a moment of silence as we gather our thoughts together. Please remember, this is not a time for you to hear me pray. Corporate prayer is a time for all of us to pray together, as together we lift our prayers to the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this morning we come before your throne, and as we sang that old hymn, How Great Thou Art, I pray that we are reminded of what that means. You are great. In fact, you're the best. You're excellent. There is no flaw or failure in you. And Father, that is a good word for us today, your children, because you love us perfectly. You are with us perfectly. Even when you don't do the things we ask you to do, the way you do them is perfect, even if we can't see that. Lord, we are thankful for your hand that's always guiding us. We're thankful for the mercy that you give us on a daily basis. And God, we are so thankful for the grace that covers us when we falter and fail, when we make the wrong decisions, when we do the wrong thing in spite of knowing what the right thing is. You're always there with grace and forgiveness. And I'm thankful for that today, God. I just pray that your spirit would hover over us today and dwell us, that we would feel that presence very real. I pray, Lord, that any burden that we have today, that we would lay that down, give that to you, and just trust you with it, God. Too many times we hand it to you and then we try to take it back. We hand it to you and we try to take it back. Help us to give it to you and let go of it. Lord, you are the only one that can handle whatever it is we're going through. Whether that's emotional, spiritual, physical, you can handle it, and we trust you with it. Lord, I thank you for this church that we're part of. I thank you for the ministries that we are able to be a part of. As we look at these cards in our sanctuary today, these are just snapshots of the things that we're allowed to do for you, and you give us the things that we need to be able to do these, and the people to volunteer to be a part of those things. And Lord, I'm thankful for the people that they impact in our community of faith that we live in. Lord, I'm thankful for Clay and his ministries that he's a part of. We just pray over him as he comes today to share what you've laid on his heart. We pray that you would bless his ministry, God, that is having a major impact in his community of faith. Lord, we're thankful for him and those that are with him and their willingness to serve. Lord, as we think about our church, we want to be a family, a community of faith, a community of faith that's not locked inside, but a community of faith that goes and extends outward. As we share the good news of who you are, you've called us to make disciples, and we want to be about that business, Lord. So open those doors, continue to show us where we can do the work that you're calling us to do. As we live in this world, Lord, and we find ourselves in this political arena, it's so easy to get caught up in presidents and senators and congressmen. It's so easy to put all of our hope in those structures. And Father, I do believe you call us to vote, and we need to vote our conscience as we do that. But help us to be reminded that it doesn't matter who's in the White House. It don't matter who is the senator or the congressman, for you are in control. And no matter who occupies those places, we can trust you, Father. And we need to hold tightly to your hand. As we see the different things going on around the world, the conflicts in Russia and Ukraine, in the Middle East and in Israel, remind us, Lord, that you aren't surprised by any of these things. You're in control. And Lord, today we can trust you with all these things. Give us a peace in our hearts, Lord. Remind us of the love that you have for us and the hope we have of eternity. We pray all these things, trusting and hoping in you. We love you, Father. In your name we pray. Amen.
All right. Our song we're going to sing is Rescue the Perishing, but I want to put in my little plug about Mission Day real quick. We're going to leave these up for next week because we don't want to take a lot of time. I want Clay to preach and for us. But I think we're going to tell you a little bit more about each mission maybe. I hadn't talked to Lee about that yet, but he'll probably let us do that. But if you have time, come a little early. Read the posters. Look at the little visuals and think about it and thank God for it. We need some more volunteers. We've got a lot going on. I want to read this right here on the third verse of Rescue the Perishing. Down in the human heart, crushed by the tempter, feelings lie buried that grace can restore. Touched by a loving heart, wakened by kindness, chords that are broken will vibrate once more. And to me, that's what missions is about. It's not that the kids get all the school supplies. That's great. It's not that, you know, everybody gets a free pair of underwear or, you know, you can come get food. It's that we love these people, and we've got to show that love of Jesus. And I think that's what a big part of missions and what the Lord wanted us to do. Because if we can love them here and the Lord pours that grace and we share that love in our heart from him, those cords do wake up. Too many people will tell you, talk to people, it does, and then they say, man, that's me. He loves me. He can love me. And so to me, that's a big part of missions, and I think that's why I really like it. And we need some help. We're growing. They're coming this way. So I appreciate all y'all do. I mean, our churches, y'all are wonderful. All right, we're going to sing Rescue the Perishing. It's four verses. Let's stand.
Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Weep o'er the erring one, lift up the fallen, snatch them in pity from mighty
All right, then.
Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Though they are slighting him, still he is waiting, waiting the them earnestly, plead with them gently. He will forgive if they only believe. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Down in the human heart, crushed by the tempter, by a loving heart, wakened by kindness, chords that are broken will vibrate once more. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Rescue the perishing, duty demands it. For the labor, the Lord will
Yes, Lord. Amen. Amen. You can be seated.
We're going to sing My Jesus, but you all are welcome to sing with us if you know it. We've sang it several times, so feel free to stay standing.
Wait for Miss Danielle for the children. She'll take you out. She'll take you out.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all its healing. You're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. He rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Years and tell the past to disappear. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Who can work it out for your good? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I'm loving he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen.
Amen.
You will take the cross to Calvary, pay the price for all my guilty. Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh,
he makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free.
Pretty good. I could hear y'all back there, man. That's good. Singing that. We've sung that enough. Y'all have gotten that one down. That's good. And that's a good one for kind of a ministry or evangelism. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let me tell you how he's changed my life. That is a message all of us should know, and that's the message that all of us should be able to say. The kids can go now out for Connect with Donnell. So, Clay has been a part of Celebrate Recovery for a long time over in Cordele.
What now?
And he kind of talked about that last year.
Okay.
A lot of work being done there, and a lot of lives are being changed there. Clay is an ordained pastor, and so we're also seeing lives transform. At one point, there were people who were giving their life to Christ and getting baptized. And unfortunately, some church folks got upset about that. But that, we looked at the Great Commission, right? And what did it say? Go into the world, make disciples of all people, doing what? Baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Doesn't say anything about joining church. Doesn't say anything about that at all. Unfortunately, we've connected that. And there is an aspect of being baptized and becoming a member of the church. That's important, but if you've got somebody who wants to say, I want to get baptized, you don't wait and push them off. You let them do that if they need to do that. So I think that's a good thing, and I think we need to see what it is and how God is working. But you've started a new ministry called Peniel. Is that right? Did I say that right?
Yes, sir.
All right, and he's got chains on there, and I love this idea of chains being broken, right? Because all of us, at some point in time, I've had chains on us. You could probably label that chain whatever you wanted to label it. But it maybe it was an addiction. Maybe it wasn't drugs. Maybe it was food. Maybe it was pornography. Maybe it was something else. Maybe it was anger. But God is a God that breaks chains, isn't he? And he puts us in places and positions to be able to do that. And so part of missions, I think, at the heart of missions, actually, is to be chain breakers, to go out into the world and to help people who are chained up in different ways, whether that's dealing with, you know, hunger or clothing or whatever it is that you're chained up in, to be a part of that ministry of trying to see those broken. Clay's going to come and he's going to share a little bit about his life and ministry and what's going on in those. And God's laid a message on his heart, and I hope that you'll hear that. I want to pray for Clay as you come forward, and then we'll leave it up to him. Let's pray. Lord God, as Clay comes, we just ask again that you would cover him, that you would allow his words to be your words, and Lord, that in these moments we would hear your message, and God, our lives can be transformed, and that we would leave this place a little different than we entered it in. We love you, Father. Again, we thank you for all your blessings. In your precious name, amen.
Good morning. So, really the question is on Mission Sunday, as I have a... He said I had 55 minutes. Right? And As we're discussing missions, and there's many missions, but to me the mission is the Great Commission. And what is the Great Commission? In Matthew 28:18-20, he said, and Jesus spoke to them saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, and teaching them all things that I have bestowed upon you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Amen. And so, the two ministries that I am involved in, I believe, carry out the Great Commission. One of them will be carrying out the Great Commission, but the Celebrate Recovery carries out the Great Commission in a way that would be a little bit unorthodox to the church, per se, and that you know, we do try to make. That key verb is make. So we make disciples. We share the gospel. We baptize, but then the teaching of everything the way you would disciple somebody who's lost in addiction is a little different than you would the everyday churchgoer. We use something called the 12 steps as a discipleship mechanism, and basically we give them the tools to stay sober. And so I think I have some pictures, if they'll pull them up, of some things that right there we have started back in June, a men's discipleship program where because everybody was giving Clay a hard time and saying, "Hey, Clay, you know, a bunch of people are being... you know, getting saved, but what are you doing to disciple them?" And pointing the finger like Clay's supposed to do all the work. And so I started challenging the churches to come alongside me and help. And so on Tuesday mornings at 6:30, you know, we've had up to 40-something guys in there. And we'll start off the morning talking about how where we've seen God at work that week. And then we'll go through just a couple of verses. We've been working our way through the Gospel of John. And only gotten through a couple of chapters in 3 months, and then we end with holding hands like this, and going around and sharing our burdens and praying for each other. So what we got next? That's some of us sitting at a table. That's what we're doing when we're actually going over the scripture. You can go ahead. There we have that's the baptism. We have one at the Flint River by the Power Dam in Warwick, and that's a mother and her daughter getting baptized at the same time. You can go ahead. We had a women's night of worship, and these are all ministries just under Celebrate Recovery. So some of us men would always go to my house and we'd grill steaks and bring your Bible and stuff like that, and so the women were like, "Well, where's our steak?" And so we came together, and I came up with a plan. It was going to be like 20 women, and we were going to get steaks, and we were going to cook them for them, and next thing you know, there's like 180 women signed up, and a speaker and a worship band and all that, and there's us. God was in it because it worked, so it we didn't have any failures that night. Go to the next one. That was, I think, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, So, man, I'm going to tell you, every one of those dudes in that picture, including myself, have not just been drug addicts, but I'm talking about like prison, needles, homeless, the whole nine yards. And some of them are still sober till today. The mom and daughter and the other three girls, they weren't really in addiction like us guys. But that group of guys right there is, man, that's a glory to God moment. Just to see these guys, and the greatest thing about seeing when men get it right is that they can go home to their families and lead their families right. And so you can go to the next one. That's one. So there's a famous thing going on at Shauna Patterson's house, and that's there was actually some people that came forward and joined the church at Pena Baptist. Terry Ryan's one of my good friends, and Tim Bruning comes forward with his family, and he has not been baptized yet, and he says in front of Pena like 200 people, and he says, "I'm getting baptized at Shauna's by Clay." I'm like, good night, you're going to have these people getting aggravated with me. But anyway, so we go to Shauna's, and the cool part about that is that's after Celebrate Recovery's over, man. You'll see 30, 40 people there, and this is like at 9:30 at night, and just celebrating, and you know, what is baptism? You know, there's a lot that me and Pastor Lee discussed that we feel it's an outward expression of what's happened internally. I believe it's representation of what Romans 6 says when we're being buried with Christ and being raised to walk in His image. And that's what I tell every one of them. I say, hey, guys, I can baptize you, but you're the one that's telling the world that, hey, I'm going to be raised up out of this water and I'm going to live for Jesus. And so if your actions don't follow that, that's on you. So it's a serious task to make that public profession, I feel like. All right, we can go to the next one. There's the women's conference again. You can see Pastor Larry way, way off in the back. Even put him to work. All right, go ahead. Look at that. Who do y'all think that is? Man, you know, it's kind of weird because Miss Lori is like a mother to me. And if we're being honest, you know, she'll say I'm one of her pastors, but she's almost like one of my spiritual mentors, so I don't really know how that works. You know, Miss Lori has the God's gift to tell Clay exactly like it is, even when I don't want to hear exactly like it is. Maybe y'all have been a recipient of that yourself, so I don't know, but I love her. All right, go ahead. That was it? Huh? That was a rededication. You know, Lori had done it when she was early, and her and a lady named Shauna, they basically wanted to remember their baptism. So, because they were little girls. And so that's what we did. All right. So the Great Commission we make, so we share the gospel, and we baptize, and we disciple by mechanism of the 12 steps. But you see, when we're starting the thing at Chick-fil-A, we're actually taking it a step further for the guys that want something more. And then we work with the local churches. There's a different local church or local ministry that serves dinner every Tuesday night. And you know, they get to come, and we get free dinner, and they, you know, we get to say, whoever the pastor is from there will come up, and they get to say, hey, I'm Aaron Moore from Northern Heights, and we meet at such and such time, and we'd love to have you if you don't have a church home. And so it's kind of a way for our people, because some of our people that are unchurched don't, just going to be honest with y'all, they don't really trust y'all. And that's the truth of the matter, you know. And so we kind of blend them together so that eventually that they will start to trust church people and see that they're not so bad. Peniel Recovery Ministries. That's going to be a men's recovery home in Vienna, Georgia. We got 10 acres of land. We're building a house. Hopefully it'll be open by the end of this year. It's going to be a 4 to 16 month program for men to come. And what better way to disciple men than if you have them fully in your grasp for 16 months? And so, you know, it'll be reconciliation at its best. You know, give these guys the tool to stay sober and send them home and to their families and hopes that, you know, there's a statistic that says that if, and I don't know the two statistics by heart, but I'm just going to take a wild guess. It's something like if a child comes to know Christ and they go home, it's like 3% of the time the families will get converted. And then if a mother comes to know Christ and comes home, it's somewhere in the 17% range. But if a man comes to know Christ, 97% of the time his family will follow. So, men, we're made to be the spiritual giants at our home and lead our families. Which isn't always easy in ministry. So, why is the Great Commission so important? I'm going to give you two reasons. Two things that each and every one of us will hear one day when we pass away. We're either going to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant," or we're going to hear, "Depart from me, I never knew you." You know, I've had an evangelist come and train my CR leaders in hopes that they would start sharing the gospel too. You know, it's our part to share the gospel, and the gospel's not that complicated. We can make it complicated, but it's as simple as this. He always was. He came. He died. He rose. And he lives. I have been told by a certain young lady in here that not everyone wants to share the gospel. Everybody don't want to go to Walmart and just tell people about Jesus. So I've started pressing them, like, so we have a bunch of people that come forward and we don't keep a number on it, but a lot of people that come forward, and you know, you really, when you're fishing in a pond where nobody's heard the gospel and you present the gospel, it's like fishing in a stock pond. And so I'm gonna tell you all, how many of you, by show of hands, if you don't feel comfortable, raise your hand, how many of you have shared the gospel with somebody? Okay, good deal. A good old Baptist preacher, Romans Road, says that the wages of sin is death, and the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. It says that we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. Romans 3:10 will say that there are none of us that are righteous, no, not one. Romans 5:8 will say, but God demonstrated his love for us, and that yet while we were sinners, Christ died for us. And so now we get to it. How do you do it? How do you obtain salvation? Romans 10:9 says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So sometimes I would just simply say a prayer like that. There was a time where when people would come forward, I would come up with all these fancy prayers that I thought were real fancy. I'd even write them down, and because maybe if the prayer's a little bit better, it'll work a little bit better. And now I just simply just ask them, let's pray Romans 10:9. Jesus, you are my Lord. I believe that you died for me. I believe God raised you from the dead. Please save me. Amen. And guess what? It's in their heart that the salvation happens. No matter what we say, no matter what we lead them through, it's not going to make a difference. As long as you can Romans 10:9 it. One guy told me, Clay, it's as simple as ABC. Admit you're a sinner, believe Christ died for you, confess him as Lord. ABC. And so, what time do I got to be through, Pastor Lee? That was the introduction. I'm gonna tell you why I'm gonna try really quickly to explain to you in my heart why the Great Commission is so important. And how we could, even myself, I've only been saved for a little over 5 years, and you could come into salvation as one thing, and if you're not careful, you could drift into something entirely different. What do you mean by that? So how many of you like to go to the beach? All right. So as a kid, my dad used to take us to St. George Island every summer. And if any of you know Roy Johnson, he would be out there with a pole set up trying to catch a whole bunch of whiting. And so we always knew as kids that that was the base of operations, where Dad and Fran and everybody was set up. We didn't get far from there because you didn't want to get on Dad's bad side. So me and Mark were out in the ocean, swimming around, looking for sand dollars, doing what kids do. We're out there for hours, what it seemed like. And before you know it, we kind of got hungry. And so we look up and we start looking around, fixing to walk back to shore, and man, we don't see Dad anywhere. And as a matter of fact, it's not that we don't see Dad anymore, but the cottage moved. And so then we start walking to the shore and we realize that, hey, we had done drifted a long ways away. And so I'm going to lead into that, and I was going to be in Genesis, and God told me this morning to read something totally different, and sometimes I'm confused when he wants me to do this, but I just do it anyway. And so I'm going to read out of the book of Luke, chapter 15. And I'm going to read the story that we all know very well, the prodigal son. And what I want to say is that in the very beginning of chapter 15, the first couple of verses says, "Then all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to him to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes complained, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.'" So what does Jesus do? He places the Pharisees in the story and then tells a story. But before he gets to that story, he tells two more parables, both ending with, one's the parable of the lost coin. "When the coin is found, likewise I say to you, there is joy in the presence of angels of God over one sinner who repents. In the parable of the lost sheep, I say to you that likewise there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance." You see, in recovery, Celebrate Recovery, Peniel Recovery Ministries, that's what we're going. We're just wishing and hoping that God will allow us to see prodigals come home. And we'll start in verse 11. "Then he said, 'A certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me.' So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, all together journeyed to a far-off country. And there wasted his possessions with prodigal living." Now, some of you might not know this about me, but you know, my daddy was a pretty good wealthy businessman, and there came a point in time where I didn't go asking for my inheritance. You see, believe it or not, I graduated from a good little Christian private school, and class of 19 people, Crisp Academy, 2098. Life handed on a silver spoon. All-state football, all-state basketball. All the good stuff. But what I wanted was to do what Clay wanted. I didn't want no part of running the family business and an honest living. I liked women, and I liked getting high. And I liked a lot of it, if we're being honest. And so it came to a point in time where I didn't ask my dad, but I just started taking from him. I took my inheritance. When I was 20 years old, I forged a $30,000 loan in my daddy's name. And my daddy paid for it. He actually used the company to pay that debt off for me. Then several years after that, for a series of months, I would go grab brand new wire out the warehouse, and I would take it out in the field, and I would draw it off and make it look like it was used from a construction site. Hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of wire I stole from my dad. So I could say I got my inheritance from him. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed with the swine. There came a point in time where my family gave up on me, and they just didn't want any part of Clay anymore. And it was in that point that I went from a private school Christian graduate with everything handed to him to living in a storage building with the mice. I shared a storage building with the mice. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare? And I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.'" I got out of prison on July 13, 2018. It was in Coastal State Prison over close to Savannah. Got on a Greyhound and made that long ride to the Albany Greyhound station where my dad was waiting on me. And all I asked from my dad is that, "Hey, can you just let me work at the farm with Bobby? Just cut grass. I just want to live at your house. I don't want my job back. I just want to live with you." I'd gotten to that place where I was eating with the swine. I came to myself. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry." My dad didn't go kill a cow, but on the way home he did stop at Striplin's and get a steak. And I'm just going to tell you, that's pretty close. "For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. And he was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Now his older son was in the field. And as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, 'Your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf.'" You see, the older brother in the story is the Pharisee. "But he was angry and would not go in." Keep in mind, when we become the Pharisee, that when the some commentaries say that this is an illustration of the party that's going on in heaven. This guy wouldn't even go into the party in heaven. He'd rather sit outside and pout. "And because he received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, 'Lo, these many years I have been serving you. I never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat.'" It's almost like he's saying, "Hey, Dad, I kept all 613 of the laws, and I didn't get a goat." that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed the fatted calf for him. And he said to him, Son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad. Brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is now is found. Winning the lost is very important. I'm sure that y'all watch the news. I don't. I have four felonies, so I can't vote, so there's no point. The greatest gift that I ever did get to give my dad passed away October 31st of this past year. And there was a part of me that thought I was really angry because there was so much that we had left to do together. I'm just now sober. But the greatest gift I ever could have gave my dad was for him to die knowing I was sober. And so that day, as me and Mark were walking back from the beach, lo and behold, nearly a mile away, we found him. You see, my father never went anywhere. It was I that drifted. And so we can come to this place to where we get saved and we're all in, and or whatever the case, whatever that looks like for you. But before you know it, we don't even hear the voice of God anymore. Matter of fact, you know, we're reading our Bible, it's not speaking back to us, we're praying, we're just going through the motions, we're checking off boxes. But just as my dad had never left that spot, God the Father has never left his spot either. He's sitting there waiting on you. So when we get detached, it's us that needs to run back to the Father. And so, today, as I get ready to close out, I'm going to just give an invitation. And we're going to pray that God would do what only He can do. Don't know where y'all at. We might be in a sanctuary full of people that have completely sold out to Jesus, and praise God if so. But I believe we always need to give the invitation just in case. So if y'all would stand with me, please. Let's pray. God, thank you that no matter how far we can drift, you're always right there waiting on us. And there's always a path to get back to you. God, for someone here that may know you, but maybe not as their Lord and Savior, God, would you convict hearts as you see fit to? Would you draw people to you as you see fit? In Jesus' name. So with every head bowed, every eye closed, in this moment, if God's telling you that it's time to get right with Him, if that's you, it's just as simple as, would you raise your hand so that I could pray for you? Thank you. Is there anyone else? Thank you. Is there anyone else? Okay. Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. So as we said earlier, I've already went over all the instructions that I got, and I'm not some mastermind at this, but I would ask Pastor Lee to come stand up here with me. And I'm going to lead us through a prayer, and it's a prayer that we can all pray. Just as simple as this, you just repeat after me. Jesus, you are my Lord. I believe that you died for me. I believe that God rose you from the dead. Please save me. Amen. I'm going to do it a little bit different, so I want everybody just to kind of look up for a moment. I'm going to give you an opportunity to publicly profess what you just did. And why would I do that? Because I'm leaving this place. I saw who raised their hand, but I don't know who you are. But I know that Pastor Lee wants to have some follow-up conversations with you. And he wants to plug you into the right spots, because it does not say, the Great Commission doesn't say to go lead them in a prayer and slap them on the butt and send them out the door. It says to make disciples, to baptize, and to teach. How's Pastor Lee going to teach you if you don't even know who raised their hand? Why am I doing it with everybody looking? I used to do this with everybody's eyes closed still. But I'm going to be honest with you. I would rather you be bold in front of a room full of people that love you and want to celebrate with you and say, you know what, I made a decision. Because if you can't do it with everybody looking in here that wants to celebrate with you, literally, it's going to be a lot harder to do it when you walk out them doors. So if you made that decision, as they play this last song, would you just come forward and talk with me and Pastor Lee? We invite you to come.
How you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line, with all the other not quites, with all the never get it rights. But it turns out you're the ones you were looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Moses had stage fright, and David brought a rock to a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is, everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? Say, I'm a nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought, faithful member of a family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm just a nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing.
to see nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see nobody but Jesus.
Amen.
I was thinking the same thing.